So challenges for home economists. I'm sure many of you will find familiar faces. I was looking for a photograph of home economists on the internet, and I found this picture, which is from the IFHE Sudan meeting. And it shows a very vibrant group from all over the world. So I put it up here so that we can all identify with it and be proud of our profession. So what can we do? So we have, like I said, there are five needs: high health, finance, the ability to be productive and contribute, the connections and social factor, and recreation and fun. So we as home economists, I mean, these are areas where we are all working in. We've all studied about, and therefore we can offer or develop products, services to cater to these five needs of the elder people. So whether you're working through an NGO, as an entrepreneur, as a corporate, in a university, we can all use these models and benefit the elderly. Like I said, we need to see whether the elderly are able to cope up with our fast-changing world. And that is how to manage life's transitions well is another thing which home economists are very strongly targeted to, because we are basically learning life skill development. So coping with life's transitions would be another area where we can contribute very, very effectively. And you know, it's even a simple thing like even cooking. A lot of people have gone back to cooking in the COVID times. Even stitching a button today. Ask a youngster to stitch a button, they'll say, "Oh, dump the garment, throw away the garment," and not stitch the button. So managing life skills, managing life's transitions, right from these basic facts to coping with depression, to coping with, you know, counseling, to talking to a community, to having neighborhood feeling, all these is something that we are very well trained for. So, like I said, start young. What can we do? We need to target the elderly of tomorrow, have a life course approach. Of course, promote lifestyle modification, which is diet, exercise, stress, and habits, which we need to look at. Very important for elderly is to inculcate some hobbies. You're working all your life. You're so busy that you don't have time for any social interaction. You don't have time for any hobbies. And suddenly one day you retire. And you have all the time in the world and you don't have anybody to talk to or do anything. So it's very important, even during working life, to inculcate some hobby, whether it is painting, it's singing, it's dancing, it's playing golf, it's playing cards, whatever, stitching, knitting, anything which would keep you busy later on. And of course, the health part is very important. Another area which is very, very crucial is barrier-free environment. Assistive devices, how to prevent falls and fractures. Falls and fractures are the biggest factor which affect the quality of life in the elderly. And to prevent falls and fractures, you know, things, simple things like having railings, avoiding a carpet, having the right lighting, all these would make a tremendous difference on the quality of life of the elderly. And we are trained in even doing these kind of things. And then, of course, the technology aspect of it is very, very important, where we can contribute to guiding the elderly, to developing programs for them, developing short videos for them, taking care of all their requirements and needs. And then, of course, if you look at the care of the elderly, trained caregivers is a big, big deficit today. So we as home economists could train caregivers. The program that we have started in Delhi University was basically training managers for elderly care homes. You can have geriatric caregivers, whether they are household or family or they are professional, people who could run daycare homes, old age homes, all these we need to train. So it's whether it's a counselor, whether it's a caregiver, whether it's a designer of barrier-free environment, all these are different aspects of the geriatric care which we can all contribute to. And whether it's community kitchens, providing nutrition care, diet, these are very, very important. And then, of course, developing products to meet special needs. So even assistive devices, even a simple thing like a walking stick, which has an alarm, was developed by somebody so that when the elderly, if the elderly falls, the alarm rings. So people around get to know something is wrong, you know, or a security system in the house, a special hearing aid, a special feeding cup. You know, these are small things which, again, our design experts can do as part of home economics. Then, of course, the financial and social security, how to keep them occupied. Maybe in those who can afford to, can do social service. We can support them in entrepreneurship activities, in community activities. You know, we in the COVID times, because people were not ordering food from the restaurant, there were a lot of elderly women who were sending it to their neighbors and all, and then they started a business. So entrepreneurship. So at 80-year-old, this woman became an entrepreneur because she was making traditional, simple, homemade food and distributing it to people in the colony. So these are entrepreneurship activities, everything which would improve their not only financial security, but also their socio-psychological framework. So here, family structures. Look at the picture on top. I'm sure all of you have faced this in your family. Everybody sits on the dining table with their phone in front of us, and nobody's talking to each other, and yet you are all together for dinner. So I think it's very important to promote intergenerational programs. Programs in schools, programs with both elderly and young people. And then, of course, we must help the elderly maintain social networks. So organize groups, organize activities for them. You know, even a simple thing like offering to take an elderly to meet her friend is something which would mean a lot to an elderly person. And then, of course, because aging in place is a new norm, we need to support the family in caring for the elderly. Simple thing like if the family wants to go for a wedding out of station for 2 days, can somebody volunteer to stay with that elderly person for 2 days? It could be a big help. So whether it's paid or it's not paid, that is a different model that we can design. Okay, for elder abuse, definitely we must have counseling, we must have caregiver training, we must have self-care groups. We should have activists amongst us in not getting abused, or at least in standing up for their protection. Disasters and all, like I said, we need, again, in every community, there should be a group of older persons who could get together in times of disaster and support the elderly who were already living there. So it could be older persons or young persons, but definitely, you know, come to the help or the assistance of the elderly. And side by side, we need to train the elderly. We need to improve their skills and abilities so that they are able to cope up with it. A simple thing like if there's a fire, can the elderly walk down the stairs? So they should be functionally independent to be able to walk down the stairs in an emergency instead of taking the lift or the elevator. So education, of course, goes hand in hand. All these things need to be coupled with education. Very important thing is to overcome ageism. And, like the term elderly was considered to be a negative term. And some time back, there was this change or suggestion to at the International Federation of Aging to change the term to silver citizens, which gives them a much more positive impression rather than saying elderly. So we need to really look at how we can prevent the ageism. And also for that, we need to support them to age well. Okay, and of course, the demand for goods and services. So side by side, there would be demand for home care, daycare, clubs, recreation facilities, counseling, meals on wheels, mobile libraries, senior citizens, colonies. All these, the demand will keep increasing. And this is all, basically, if you look at very closely, we all as home economists can contribute to all of these. These are skills which we, with a little bit of honing, with a little bit of extra training, we can easily contribute to these. And then, of course, technology. Telemedicine is very, very in with wearable gadgets and diagnostics. So at one time, you had a very bulky blood pressure measuring system. Today, you have a digital one. And you have FaceTime, you have WhatsApp, you have, you name it. So it's important to train the elderly, to orient them, to be able to cope up with these things, because this will improve their connectivity, their connectedness with the society, and also improve their quality of life. What happens in COVID? So this was a very interesting article in the Wall Street Journal recently. I just took a few of these pointers from there. So they said, we are going to have to plan for dying. All of us have suddenly become very conscious of a healthy lifestyle. We are having a lot of immune boosters, a lot of minerals, a lot of vitamins. We are eating healthy suddenly because of the COVID. And that's a good thing. Like I said, we may have to work longer. We may have to save more. And this is an important financial implication which will happen. And I said, the intergenerational battle or divide is getting wider. And that is something we really need to really do something for that fast, because that's not a good sign. And besides that, the break from routine and the free time that one has now makes us think about a lot of other things and plan our value systems and our what do we want to leave behind, what do people remind us about. I mean, really talk about philosophical issues. And of course, we have to know that the clock is ticking, because it's very unpredictable until we have a treatment or a vaccine for it. And all the elderly are really a worried lot. Okay, so this was a study which we had done for IFHE about 8-10 years back. And this was a situation of the elderly. And we took six countries from virtually six continents. And from that, we talked to the elderly, we surveyed them, we got a lot of data. And these were the recommendations which came out. And many of them I've covered. So they said creating awareness, accessibility, barrier-free environment, developing guidelines for home economics training. So our home economics curriculum has to be modified now to look at this large section of population. Our curriculum is not geared towards aged care. We do have a lot of child focus, and maybe we do need to look at this and develop self-help booklets, guides, manuals. Another very important thing is document traditional wisdom. We are fast losing out on this, you know. You'll find even a simple thing like recipes. When the elderly in the family passes away, the recipe is lost. Even home remedies, even skills like embroidery, like knitting, like crochet, these skills are getting lost. You know, so we really need to document traditional wisdom so that these skills can be transferred to the next generation. And of course, like I said, the home economics training, the home economics focus, we really need to increase the focus on the elderly. So this was just a brief from that study. So at the end, I would just say we should acknowledge the elderly, the resilience and the power of old people. And they find that several studies have shown that even in this COVID time, the older adults are coping emotionally better than the younger ones. And I'll leave you with this message. And as I said, we are truly multidisciplinary, and home economists are equipped to meet the challenges of aging. It's only that we need to give a little more focus to it and step out into this arena. So thank you very much.